Hi there, with this video I want to conclude my review of the Pi Moroni Enviro Plus board. In part 1 I covered the triple gas sensor and associated analog to digital converter, the temperature, pressure and humidity sensor and the particulate matter sensor. If you haven't seen part 1, I leave a link in the description below. In this video, I'm looking at the two remaining sensors, the MEMS microphone and the light and proximity sensor, and briefly look at the LCD display that's part of the board. Let's start with the LCD, because it's by far the easiest of the remaining lot. So I guess it's finally time to peel the protective film off and bring it to life. The LCD is a 0.96-inch color type and controlled by an ST7735 chip. Through the example code, we can deduce that the connection to the Raspberry Pi is via the serial peripheral interface or SPI bus and that the backlight control is tied to GPIO pin 12. Interestingly, the natural display orientation is portrait and therefore the setup specifies a rotation of 270 degrees to make it landscape and right side up relative to the text printed on the Enviro Plus PCB. This flexibility to flip the display is nice to know when we want to put the Enviro Plus in an enclosure. Anyway, in my little test program here, the LCD proudly presents a picture of itself on the Enviro Plus and then a greeting that crawls across the screen. Let's briefly look at how this is done. Pretty much the only thing the ST7735 driver does is display an RGB image of 60 by 80 pixels. That's it. The Python image library, or PIL, is used for everything else, like creating images and drawing or writing on them. Consulting the extensive PIL usage documentation on the web is essential if you want to do anything fancy. For PIL to write text on top of an image requires loading of a font file first. Pi Moroni delivers one as part of the examples, but you can find others on the net and use them instead. My example all use the Hack font, just as a test to try something different. The picture of the Enviro Plus is a simple image file. That picture is much larger than what the tiny display can show, so all the code here is just simply an algorithm to scale any image file up or down so that it completely fits on the LCD and is nicely centered on the background. We have then 5 seconds time to admire it before erasing it with a different background, in this case green, to go with the environmental theme and displaying a text. That text is too long to fit on the screen at the chosen font size, so I put in a rudimentary horizontal scrolling. This could be done smoothly pixel by pixel by pasting the text image with different offsets, but I couldn't be bothered and used a simple character-wise scroll in the message string itself. So with the LCD out of the way, let's continue with the microphone, which is the SPH0645. It's an interesting sensor in more than one way. To begin with, it indicates the actual physical microphone as a micromechanical system or MEMS device on the chip together with quite a bit of circuitry. These images here are actually from an excellent paper on MEMS microphones by ST Microelectronics and not the SPH0645 used on the Enviro Plus. The MEMS part is actually a silicon capacitor consisting of two plates, the rigid and fixed back plate with holes to let the sounds in and a flexible and movable plate below. Sound waves bend the lower plate and cause a change in the capacitance between the two plates. The electronics then pick up the capacitance change to create an electrical signal. According to the ST paper, the usual way of packaging MEMS microphones is shown on top. The electronics are under the sound inlet hole, protected from light and dirt by a glob of sealant. The MEMS part on the right isn't directly under the hole and therefore well protected from dust. The problem with this packaging method is the acoustics performance is not great. low signal to noise and uneven frequency response. ST has created two different methods depending on whether the MEMS microphone is soldered on a PCB with the sound coming from above or through the PCB. In the latter case, shown on the left here, the PCB has a hole lined up with a hole in the sensor. This is called bottom port, and that's what the Enviro Plus uses. The other case is called top port. It turns out that the designs need to be quite different for the two mounting positions because it makes it different whether the sound has to travel through the hole in a relatively thick PCB before reaching the MEMS or not. They also need the PCB to have a ringed metal pad around the hole and extra care during soldering to avoid any material getting inside. I don't know how the SPH-065 is constructed internally, but it certainly is a bottom port design. And the Enviro Plus PCB also has the ringed metal pad around the sound inlet. In any case, the SPH-065's frequency response looks impressively flat and is only limited by the chosen sampling rate. The frequencies shown on the graph are the chip's clock rate, and the more familiar sample rate is always 1/64th of that. So the lowest supported clock speed of 1.024 MHz means a sample rate of 16,000 samples per second, while 4.096 MHz means a sampling rate of 64,000. Besides the microelectromechanics of the microphone itself, we have a charge pump to boost the supply voltage for the two plates forming the capacitor, an amplifier, and a delta sigma converter that changes the analog data to pulse density modulated signals, which is then downsampled and converted to pulse code modulation and filtered. The result is a digital signal, in this case uncompressed PCM or pulse code modulation, similar to the familiar CD WAV file format. The chip always produces 18-bit samples sent in 3-byte strings padded by 6 0 bits. This padding is at the LSB end, so the sample values are shifted 6 bits to the left or appear as being multiplied by 64. The I2S clock frequency not only determines the sampling rate, it also turns the microphone on when at or above 1 MHz or off when below. The Enviro Plus has only one microphone, but it's possible to connect two of the chips to the same I2S bus and using the select tied either to ground or VCC to designate one of the chips as the right and the other one as the left channel. The bus master can select getting samples from the chip for the left or the right channel by choosing the WS or white select signal to be either high or low. The non-selected microphone then goes tree state to let the other one take over. And just to avoid confusion, the chip uses the I2S or inter-IC sound bus, which is very different from I2C or inter-integrated circuit bus that we have used so far for most of the other sensors and the ADC on the Enviro Plus. So now that we know the chip side of things, how about the Raspberry Pi? Sadly, Pi Moron is again completely silent on how this chip or any other device on the Enviro Plus is wired to the Raspberry Pi. In this case, the silence, ironic for a microphone, goes even further. Searching for Pi Moron example code in using the microphone returns a complete blank. No schematics or sample code of anything. So much for the statement on their website suggesting Enviro Plus board owners to add Alexa skills to ask what the temperature or humidity is. Well, it turns out that Adafruit has the same MEMS chip as a separate board, and their documentation, complete with schematics, describes all the steps needed to get it working as a sound card for Arduino and Raspberry Pis. The instructions for the Adafruit MEMS microphone board assumes it's connected using the GPIO pins shown on the right here. Of course, there is no guarantee that Pi Moroni uses the same wiring, but what have we got to lose? The basic idea of the Adafruit concept is that support for I2S-based sound devices is already available in the Linux kernel, you just need to enable and rebuild it. The necessary steps are quite evolved because you need to download the Raspbian sources and recompile the I2S-based sound card into the kernel. On a rather slow Raspberry Pi Zero, this takes quite some time, but following the steps listed on their website, it was all done and ready inside 1 hour. The process is described step by step in the Adafruit documentation, which you can download from the address shown, so I'm not going to repeat it here. I also put this address in the description of this video. With the new sound card loaded, I tried the ALSA A-Record command line sound recorder and it worked, sort of. So the assumption that Pi Moroni uses the same wiring on the Enviro Plus is right. But the volume is so low, as you can see from the non-moving recording level bar at the bottom, that you have practically to shout into the Enviro Plus to get anything audibly played back. Luckily, the notes on the Adafruit tutorial explain how to make it work with the ALSA mixer, which allows you to crank up the recording level. Using F6 to choose our sound card, okay, it's a microphone, so only capture is supported, that is F4, and let's crank up the volume. Say 50%. After using ALSA mixer to set the recording level at 50% and changing the device in A record to DMIC_SV in accordance with the Adafruit instructions, I am recording this using the Enviro Plus MEMS microphone and a record set to 44,100 samples directly into a WAV file on the Raspberry Pi. You can see that the recording level bar is doing something. What you hear is the recording after I copied it from the Raspberry Pi and synchronized it with the video when I was making it. So, apart from the initial plop, the audio quality of the recording is quite usable. The problem now is how to use this in a program. My first straightforward attempt was to automate the manual recording I just did. For that, I first created a small RAM disk to reduce the wear on the SD card, because in this approach I will be constantly creating and overwriting a WAV file. The little Python program you see here simply calls a record to record 5 seconds worth of data in a WAV file onto the RAM disk. The -D5 parameter sets the duration in seconds. The microphone sound card is called DMIC_SV following the example in the Adafruit tutorial. We then open the WAV file and get the frame rate and sample size and number of frames from the header. The program then reads the complete recording both channels into a byte array called sData. Both channels for one microphone. If you followed Adafruit's tutorial, recording from the microphone sound card through the ALSA mixer for higher sound levels forces a record to do a stereo recording. It's just the way some default is set that doesn't allow a record to use only one channel with that sound device. I know how to change it, but I decided to use their setup unchanged. It's easy enough to ignore the right channel, which is of course always silent if you only have one microphone, as in our case. So the next step is to convert the whole recording from bytes into 32-bit integers, which is really just changing the way we access the data without needing any actual conversion. Because it's two channels, the integers are interleaved, left, right, left, and so on. A simple slice operation fishes out all even integers into a new array called left, and similar, a slice would take care of the odd ones for right, but to save CPU cycles, I disable the write channel extraction. At the same time, I convert the 32-bit integers into floats. 32-bit integers are hard to work with, especially when, for calculating an average, you need to sum them without risking an overflow. Converting them to float takes care of that. The final steps are three simple operations to find the maximum, minimum and average of all the 5 seconds times 44,100 samples per second or 220,500 samples in the recording of the left channel and print them out. Then the program simply repeats in getting a new 5 seconds recording and overwriting the old one on the RAM disk. Well, this works, sort of, but not very practical, because the program sits there and waits during the recording, and of course nothing is recorded while we process and analyze the data. We would have to at least run this as a separate thread to be able to continue processing data from other sensors during the recording. Stopping isn't the easiest too. Much more problematic is the data we are getting. Huge max and min values, every time. Even though the A record bar showed there was a near total silence and hence we would expect values close to zero. It is time to look at the recorded buff data more closely using the brilliant open source audio editor Audacity. Here is Audacity's plot of the recording of 10 seconds of silence. We can see the huge plop at the beginning. This explains the large minimum and maximum values shown by my program. Then over the next 1 second or so, the level slowly drops until it reaches a steady level at pretty much 50% of the negative range. If this were an analog signal, measured for example in an old school amplifier, you would immediately suspect a capacitor problem, with a plop at the beginning and a large negative DC offset. Yet this signal is purely digital. The plop at the beginning is probably the charge pump in the chip starting up and supplying the MEMS plates when waking up from sleep. While we can deal with a constant DC offset, the plop at the beginning rules out any hope of using this approach for anything close to real-time processing, because it occurs at the beginning of every A-record recording. Every time a recording is finished, the chip goes back to sleep and therefore the next recording will have a plop. On the other hand, if you are only interested in capturing noise statistics every minute or even longer, the approach is still a possibility. You could simply discard the first 2 seconds of every recording before starting the analysis. To resemble anything close to real-time analysis, we must not let the microphone go to sleep and restart all the time. In other words, we need to access it as a source of constant streams of audio samples. To do this, I installed the Pi Audio package and port audio on which it depends. From the API and the example, it should be possible to connect to the microphone as a sound card and read samples as a stream directly. The first hurdle in using Pi Audio is finding the device index, which is expected as a parameter in opening the stream. The examples I found online are not helpful in that they always assume the defaults will just work. Moreover, it seems that the Pi Audio API has two kinds of indices, an API index and a device index, and it isn't always clear which one is needed where. The good news is that there are lots of get discovery methods, but nothing really describing what they do and how to interpret the return stuff. In the end, I used my tried and tested method of calling them all and simply print the returns to analyze the results. So all this code here is not really needed. All I used it for is to find out what number to put there. I'm not sure if the results would always be the same for other Raspberry Pis, so you may have to do a similar journey of discovery in your setup. Here is a run of it. For now, let's concentrate only at the start sequence. It is quite difficult to read, so I captured the terminal output into a text file to study it closer. You can see that Pi Audio is not at all happy about the sound setup on this Raspberry Pi. I suspect a good deal is because, in following the Adafruit instructions, we have only implemented the most rudimentary of driver metadata, and so lots of the more advanced audio device lookup information Pi Audio's initialization routines attempt fail with scary messages of stuff not being found, but at least it keeps going. The information returned from the Pi Audio get function is in the form of dictionaries, which I simply dumped on the screen without any attempt of formatting, because I wasn't sure what I would get in the first place and whether it made any sense, so excuse the mess. I should also state that I'm no expert in the mysterious world of the Linux and ALSA sound architecture. I just want to get my stream going, so do not expect any explanations as why things are this way. So here we learn that the default host API is ALSA with 6 devices and a default input device number 2 and a default output device of 0. Next we learn all about the default input device with the index 2. It's called SND RPI Simple, which is the catchy name Adafruit have used in their tutorial for the microphone, but it's not what they are using for a record, which is DMIC SV, if you recall from earlier on. Here we learn there are in fact two host APIs, ALSA and OSS. The key difference is that ALSA has 6 devices and default input and output devices, and OSS has 0 devices and therefore of course no default input and output devices. This means we can concentrate on ALSA as the host API. I'm now printing the device info for each ALSA device. Remember, there are 6 of them. Index 0 is the PMC 2835 associated with the HDMI port. And we can forget it, because while it has 8 output devices, it has 0 input devices. Index 1 is for HDMI 1. Who knew there were 2? But again, we can ignore it because it has no input channels. Index 2 is the default input device from earlier, and it's our microphone, but probably not going through the ALSA mixer. We have up to 2 input channels, and interestingly, we also have 2 outputs. It's probably again a sign of using defaults for device property records. Index 3 is a device called DMIC underscore HW, and it's usable for recording. It has an input channel, it has 2 input channels, but I'm not sure what difference, if any, it makes. Index 4 finally is DMIC SV. It's the one that Adafruit's example for a record is using. Index 5 is called DMIX, and as you can see, it has no input channels, so we can therefore ignore it. So we can use indices 2, 3 or 4, with 4 being our best bet for now. With the device index problem sorted, we can start opening the stream from device 4 and reading chunks of samples. What we get back from Pi Audio is identical in format to the WAV file reading earlier, an array of bytes representing a stream of 32-bit integers. Again, with 2 channels, the samples would be alternating between left and right channels, but unlike a record, the stream API has no issue with asking only for 1 channel, so we can convert everything into an array of floats without slicing. In this example, I've set the chunk size to be the same as the sample rate, which means I'm getting 1 second worth of data in every chunk. The process is fairly straightforward. I keep incrementing a seconds counter every time I'm reading a chunk. This allows me to skip the first 2 seconds after reading the stream, because we know that it will contain only the distorted block data. I'm then using the next second to establish the DC offset, so we need silence during that 1 second. The next is the usual min-max calculation, but this time corrected for the DC offset. To make it easy to see changes, I normalize the max-min values against full range, so the R-max and R-min value represent percentages, and for good measures, R-max is also printed as a rudimentary bar graph, each element representing 10%. You can see this program works great. We can see how the bar graph responds to the sound level, for example, clapping. However, with 1 second delay, of course. To reduce this latency, we can reduce the chunk size, but we need to be careful because smaller chunks increase the CPU load, and if the program can't keep up with the stream, PyAudio will eventually raise an input overflow exception. This happened with a chunk size of 1/10 of the data rate for data rates of 44,100 and 22,000. A chunk of 5,500, that is 1/4 of the 22,000 data rate, can be sustained and reduces the latency to 250 milliseconds. You probably noticed that the program showed my clapping but not much else, so to make it more sensitive, I changed the ALSA mixer recording level to 70% to make the microphone more sensitive. That worked fine as expected, but by chance I noticed that the DC offset value printed by my program had changed significantly. To investigate further, I use a record to record 10 seconds of silence at different ALSA mixer settings of 1, 50 and 70%. It is obvious that the amount of steady state DC offset, as well as the plop at the beginning, is significantly amplified by ALSA mixer's recording level settings. At 70%, this leaves very little room for the louder parts of the actual audio, which will probably be clipped horribly. If you look at the datasheet of the chip again, it states a DC offset of 5% is typical, which is then picked up and amplified by ALSA mixer. But we don't need to go through ALSA mixer if all we want to do is amplification. I changed the program slightly. We are now using the default input device, which we know from earlier is the microphone directly and not going through the ALSA mixer. I'm using the proper API call to get the device index, which we know is 2. As I mentioned before, the program uses now 22,000 as a sample rate and a value of 1/4 of this for chunk. I changed the counting of seconds to milliseconds because now every loop happens at 1/4 of a second or 250 milliseconds. The Rmax and Rmin values are amplified by 50, a value I found by trial and error. You want good response but not overflowing. Because we remove the DC offset first, it does not get amplified with the signal and this will not therefore reduce the dynamic range. The last change is to double my rudimentary bar graph to 20. Let's see it in action. The program works fine and responds to my voice quite well. The latency of 250 milliseconds is hardly noticeable. The question now is, what are we going to do with this? If you remember, the microphone is actually labeled noise on the Enviro Plus PCB. This is a strong hint that the idea was to record noise pollution and not some Alexa gimmick. We now have the capability to measure noise, but to be able to say more than relative statements like this is pretty loud and now it's even louder, we need to somehow calibrate the microphone and our data processing. Here's a table of noise sources, mostly from Wikipedia. We can see that the sound pressure in Pascal varies over many magnitudes, and for that reason, it is usually measured in the logarithmic decibel or dB scale. in this case dBSPL, which stands for sound pressure level. Two values I want to point out. Firstly, the yellow highlighted one is the sound pressure that is commonly used as reference standard to test microphone sensitivity. You can see that 96 dBSPL corresponds to exactly 1 Pascal of pressure and is really quite loud. Secondly, the orangely highlighted value for 120 dBSPL carries the risk of instant hearing loss. This value is often selected as the upper limit a microphone can handle. As expected, our microphone datasheet states its sensitivity when exposed to a 1 kHz signal of 94 dBSPL. At that ear splitting level, its output will be typical minus 26 dBFS, dBFS standing for decibels relative to full scale. 0 dBFS means the output is at maximum level of 120 dBSPL. It took me a while to work out this table and the formula shown here because measuring sound pressure is new to me. PCM is the value of the pulse code modulation signal, in other words, the value that we read in the stream from the microphone. It's fairly easy to calculate the FS ratio, where 1 means full scale and 94 dBSPL means the value is only 5% of the full scale. In our case, the question is, what's the full scale value? If you recall, the chip itself produces an 18-bit signed value. This is represented by the FSS18 column. But the values get transmitted on the I2S bus as 3 bytes or 24-bit values representing in the FSS24 column, and the ALSA sound interface finally streams it to our program as 4 byte or 32-bit values represented in the FSS32 column. Time to go deep and look at the actual data on a bit level. Here you see 1 second worth of data directly recorded as integers from the stream. It looks normal and there are, as you would expect of course, 22,000 entries here because it's sampled at 22,000 samples per second. But if we convert it to hexadecimal, let me just do that for a few here. You notice that this is all zero here. In fact, the last 14 bits are always zero. You can test this anywhere you want. So while we are reading S32 from the stream, what we are looking at is really S18 shifted left first by 6 bits to fit into 3 bytes, and then by another 8 bits to fit into 4 bytes. In total, the PCM value from the microphone got multiplied by a factor of 16,384 before we get our hands on it. By itself, this isn't too much trouble, and if we apply the FSS32 full scale value, we will get the right results. But I like to scale the numbers back down to S18 because, for example, when we are dealing with low volumes, it is much easier to see that a PCM value of 10 in S18, for example, is really almost as low as you can possibly get compared to the equivalent value of 163,840 in S32. Based on this, I wrote a little program to do the rescaling and calculate dBSPL. It can also do recording of most of its values, and I first want to show what it does and then go over recording. First, here's the formula that converts PCM values to dBSPL. As you can see, it uses the S18 full scale value and 120 as the full scale dBSPL value. This part here sets up the recording in CSV format, and the actual recording happens down here. You can see that most of the essential variables are recorded. The real work happens here. The bytes in the stream are read and converted to 32-bit integers, then converted to float. The max and min values and averages are determined, but now scaled down by hex 4000, which is the same as 16384. By removing the average from the max and min values, we strip the DC offset, so that's why these variables are called no DC from then on. They are now just AC, reasonably symmetric around zero, one positive and the other one negative. For calculating the sound level, we only care about the absolute amplitude, not if it was negative or positive. So this section here produces the absolute value from whichever max and min had the greater absolute value. Next, the program keeps a variable called noise floor. This is the lowest observed absolute value. It is initialized to a ridiculously high value and continuously adjusted downwards. The idea here is that with total silence, the observed values are not zero. Instead, there's always some residual fluctuations and thermal and power supply noise preventing true zero. The noise floor tracks this value. Theoretically, VApps can be used to calculate dBSPL, but I found it gives somewhat too high readings. For that reason, I introduced VFinal, which is the same as VApps, but with the noise floor removed. A second dBSPL based on VFinal is then also recorded. Here's the recording of just over 2 minutes length created by the program. Immediately obvious, the plop at the beginning of every recording or stream is still there. 16,000 times smaller, but very noticeable. The comparatively huge values swamp the rest of the data when doing any plots, so let me delete the first two rows, which is the same as 2 seconds of data. Let's first look at Vmax, Vmin and average. We can see that the average, which is the same as the DC offset, slowly approaches about -66,050. It takes quite a long time to do that. Only after 2 minutes are we seeing the average being more or less horizontal. The good news is that we don't have to wait for 2 minutes or more minutes in silence. Any sound, like these spikes, cancel each other out during the averaging, so we only have to skip the initial 2 or 3 seconds. Next, let's examine Vmax, Vmin after the average or the DC offset has been removed and the Vapps value for the absolute amplitude. We can see that without the DC offset, the Vmax and Vmin are tracking nicely, symmetrically with respect to zero. The yellow Vapps line is of course positive and, for example, here and here exceed Vmax because the absolute value of Vmin was larger. Just concentrating on Vapps, the noise floor and Vfinal. You can see that the red noise floor is determined by the lowest Vapps value. It dropped slightly here and here again. The yellow Vfinal then is of course identical, to the apse in shape but offset downwards. Lastly, just the two dBSPL values. The blue value, based on the apse, is less jumpy and slightly above 50 dB. That's a bit high. Because of the effect of the logarithmic scale, the dBSPL value of the lower V final is far more jumpy. On average, it's around 40 dB. Still a bit high, but then my room has computer fans running and me breathing and all that may add up to this. I made a second version of this program, which essentially does all the same as the one I just showed, but also shows the current and max dBSPL values based on V final on the LCD. It also shows the noise floor and DC offset. Those are more for debugging, of course, and you can remove them. It records my speech at about 70 decibels. This is how it responds to clapping noises. If I had a calibrated sound level meter for comparison, it would be easy to add an adjustment value into the program. Lacking that, I guess this is as best as it goes. The optical sensor, LTR559ALS, is an interesting and relatively complex chip. It has no less than 27 data registers accessible through I2C. It combines sensing the ambient light with a proximity sensor. You will be familiar with these sensors because pretty much every smartphone contains them to adjust the screen brightness depending on ambient light and to turn the screen off when you're holding the phone against your ear during a call. The functional block diagram shows that the chip contains two sensors, one sensitive to visible and infrared and the other one to infrared only. The output of these two sensors goes into a two-channel analog-to-digital converter for processing. On the right you can see we should be able to measure illuminance from 0.01 to 64,000 lux in six ranges. There's a separate LED for emitting infrared light for the proximity sensing, which is based on how much of that infrared light is reflected from a nearby object onto the two optical sensors. Normally the LED K pin will be tied to the LDR pin and the LED A pin to the positive rail. In that configuration, the LED driver circuit in the chip controls the intensity of the emitted infrared light. As you can see in the bullets on the right, the LED drive is programmable. The datasheet shows how the light sensor values are represented by the two channels of the 16-bit ADC. Slightly worrying is the relative large variance between minimum, typical and maximum counts. Max is double the value of min. This means the accuracy of the lux reading may not be that great, and in any case, nowhere in the datasheet do we find any lux measurement accuracy value. And speaking of missing things, the datasheet contains this statement referring to Appendix A for the necessary formula to calculate lux out of the readings. That appendix is nowhere to be found. I contacted Lighteon about it some 3 weeks ago, but so far they choose to ignore me and I'm not holding my breath. But all is not lost because Pymoroni driver code actually calculates and returns lux, so I guess they were blessed in having access to Appendix A. I noticed further that the driver has recently been updated on the Pymoroni GitHub page and one of the comments refers to a change caused by something stated in Appendix A. Just briefly the specs of the proximity sensor. It basically measures the amount of light reflected from the LED. I assume the stated detection distance in the spec is supposed to be 20 millimeters as 20 nanometers is the thickness of a bacteria cell wall. We can change the LED current, which obviously changes the brightness and thus directly determines from how far away the reflection can be detected. We can further change the pulse frequency and duty cycle of the LED, probably to improve power management. I wonder if you could make it send codes to act, for example, as a TV remote, but I shall leave that to another day. For now, I want to measure illuminance. I never had a lux meter, so I'm quite looking forward to this capability. To get the right lux range from 0.01 to 64K in perspective, I noted some typical lux values here. It is clear that such a wide range of illuminance can't be covered with good resolution by 16-bit ADC, and indeed the LTR-559 splits this into 6 lux ranges overlapping by a considerable amount. The basic idea is that the higher gains are for measuring lower lux values at better resolution and a narrow range, while the lower gains are for high lux values and wider ranges. The Pi Moroni example uses a default gain of x4 and leaves it at that. They get away with that one gain fits all approach because the maximum of 16,000 lux is already quite high, and the lux calculation in a driver is a bit sloppy and does not check if a lux value is actually possible at the current gain setting. It will always happily calculate and return a lux number even if that value is not correct. In my code, I decided to implement an auto range, taking into account that this chip needs some time to respond to gain changes before it returns valid lux data again. The version you see here minimizes gain changes and works fine. It relies on the fact that the max lux values returned when out of range are wrong, but at least in the right direction. What I mean is, when a lux value is too large for its range, the reported value is not correct, but larger than the valid maximum for the range. With this algorithm, we change gain only if we need to, and then suffer an extra half second delay to let things settle again. The rest is straightforward. Lux and proximity values are shown on the LCD and can be recorded if enabled. The program keeps the maximum and minimum values for lux and proximity, and as a gimmick, proximity values over 200 will reset the maximums. This is using proximity as a button. I did change the integration time of the measurement interval from 50 milliseconds back to 100 milliseconds, which is the default in the datasheet. I don't know why the driver changed it to 50 milliseconds, possibly to get faster readings, but I think 100 milliseconds integration may improve accuracy. Because the camera picks it up, you can see the IR LED blinking, but with a naked eye, you can't obviously. When I get close to the sensor, you can see how the reflected light value increases. This is using the default 50 milliamp LED current. The lux value shows, of course, the indoor lighting level, which is very dim at the moment because I want the camera to pick up the IR LED blinking, but shining a rather bright torch on the sensor brings the value up considerably. But are the readings anywhere near to actual lux values? And what are lux values anyway? Well, in a nutshell, illuminance measured in lux is how bright something appears, taking into account the way human eye works. It is the number of lumens hitting an area. Lumens, in turn, are the quantity of visible light emitted from a source per unit time. So if you had a light source radiating a known amount of lumens, the lux number drops the further away you get because the area increases. The light spreads in a sphere, and the area of the sphere can be easily calculated. Or for a given area, you can calculate the radius of a sphere. In this diagram, I'm using a light bulb in the middle, but because it radiates only in one direction, we only need to consider half spheres. The black bar represents the Enviro Plus, in this case 1.26 meters away from the light source. Why this number and those other numbers of 0.4 and 0.9 I explain in a moment. First, let's measure some illuminance from a light source emitting a known quantity of lumens. It is easy to get a known lumen number because in Europe, manufacturers of light bulbs have to state the lumens on the packaging. This one emits 806 lumens. Here's the Enviro Plus on an improvised mount that has it on the same level and facing the bulb, which is, following the measurement tape, 1.26 meters away. The bulb in this setup is the one emitting 806 lumens. The test was done at night and no other light was on. The reading on the Enviro Plus is about 151 lux. The same setup as before, but now the Enviro Plus is only about 0.9 meters away from the bulb. And the reading has increased to 271 lux. For the last measurement, the Enviro Plus is now much closer, just 0.4 meters away from the bulb. And the reading has shot up to around 1318 lux. The distances you just saw are the radiospheres with 2, 10 and 20 square meters area. But because the light bulb shines only in one direction, we only have half spheres of light, which of course have half the area of a full sphere. It is therefore easy to calculate that a bulb of 806 lumens should produce lux numbers of 80, 161 and 806 lux. As you can see, the measured values are kind of in the right ballpark, but between 1.6 to 1.9 times too large. The three values should have a ratio of 10 to 5 to 1 because that's how the areas get smaller, but we get 8.7, 4.86 and 1 taking test 3 as 1. There could be several reasons for the error. Firstly, the bulb may be brighter than the 806 lumens. It is rated for 220 to 240 volts and I measured mains at the time of the test to be almost 239. Next, the whole calculation assumes a point source, but light bulbs with a ring of LEDs on a PCB mounted in a lampshade are far from an ideal point source. I would guess that a fair bit of the error comes from reflection of indirected light from the floor and other parts of the room on the sensor. And of course, a big source of uncertainty is the measurement accuracy of the LTR559 sensor itself. If you recall, the datasheet shows a significant difference between min, typical and max values for a given lux number. The first three error sources are not easy to eliminate, so I decided to give the sensor the benefit of the doubt, at least until I can think of a better test. When I started this review of the Enviro Plus, I thought it would be fairly straightforward. Get the datasheet for each sensor, look at the example software for each and do some experiments. Instead, this turned out to be one of the longest and complex investigations I've ever done. There's no denying, as a device to measure lots of different environmental data, the Enviro Plus has some significant shortcomings. The triple gas sensor has been delivered without reference values, so it can't be used for any quantitative measurements. You can only say if the air has now more or less possibly dangerous gases than, for example, your living room measured last week. Gas readings are also greatly affected by moving air, and the sensor definitely needs shielding from that behind a PDFE window to work reliably. For temperature, the Enviro Plus relies on the temperature sensor in the BME280, which is not meant for measuring ambient temperature at all and reads way too high values caused by self-heating of the sensor. This is independent from additional errors caused by mounting the EnviroPlus directly above the hot Raspberry Pi and cannot be compensated. To get reliable ambient temperature, you need to add your own temperature sensor, as I have shown in part 1. At least that is easy because of the spare ADC channel. Air pressure and humidity measurements are fine, no complaints here. Particulate matter sensing works well too, thanks to the brilliant PMS-5003 sensor from Plant Tower Technology, which you have to purchase separately. Despite the complete lack of documentation or examples, I got the noise sensor working, but I'm unsure about how accurate the dBSPL values really are. For the light sensor, I have similar concerns about the accuracy, but I admit that the too high lux values could have been caused by my rather crude test setup. Well, at least now you know what you're getting with the EnviroPlus. As I mentioned before, I learned a lot about very different sensors and measurements by doing these investigations, and I tried to share as much as I could. Let me know what you think in the comments. As always, the sample programs are all available on my GitHub page. Thanks for watching.